president. I still believe he mean what he says, but I don't know how what party also represents, because when Ropa was passed, I mean, his party, we know, took to the streets and other platforms to protest against it. But now he believes that it should be implemented. I believe it should be implemented because, I mean, every Ghanaian everywhere where needs to make a case or be a representative of what is happening here and should also be a part of decision making. So, I mean, it doesn't matter where you live. So I think it's a right call. People living outside Ghana should urge on the EC to, I mean, implement, if not for the 2016 election, for the 2020 election, another election beyond.
Wonderful. This is a governance issue, and so, Kofi, I wouldn't throw you into it yet, because when we get into the discussion, we'll get into it a bit further. The Medical Association, that's the Ghana Medical Association, has actually called on government to put in place some more pragmatic measures to halt the spread of cholera in the country. The association also implored the government to publish a detailed and comprehensive program informing the people about how it intended to help eradicating the disease. So that's this particular call. But it's sad that Greater Accra still leads the statistics. Now, blackout in part of central region is also captured in here. The central regional minister Akonasteri Akonsa being briefed about the incident by an official of Greatco. There was a transformer there which was destroyed by fire in a very, very sad situation, and they'll have to still sleep in darkness for a while.
I have the Ghanaian Times newspaper, and says the banner headline says, "No funds for audit service as staff using own cash." And it comes to the photograph of Richie Korte, who is the Auditor General, and also Mr. Sepekwe, the Finance Minister. And let me take snippets of that story. Page 4 of the newspaper, it says, "No funds for audit service," and it says, the story is by Charles Amankwa, who says, "Due to the delay in the release of statutory funds for the operational activities of the Ghana Audit Service, work has been hampered, leading to the failure of the service to submit the 2013 Auditor General's report to Parliament." And I don't know if you have to comment on
this. That's pretty sad. I mean, Kofi, come in briefly on this situation.
Yeah, so only Auditor General's department. You go to some other public institutions, they'll sing the same song. That at times the police service, where you go and report a case, and then you want them to ferry you, you the complainant, you are the one who must
pay for the
services rendered, because they'll tell you clearly that the money allocated has been exhausted, because so there's no money. So any other thing is coming from their own personal cost. So similar thing has been repeated here.
Yeah.
So it's, again, these are budgetary allocation issues. I don't know how soon this will be solved, because
all other government agencies are complaining.
But sometimes I have you look at
they don't have cash.
But again, the
department that we're talking about, Auditor General's department. I mean,
no, they're very crucial.
That's what I'm saying, because that is where you know how funds are. I mean, funds that have been allocated were used. Absolutely. I mean, if you don't have a results of report of what has been, I mean, accountability, how do you then go about your next budget and how to allocate the funds?
You're also making a point, but at the same time, you see, these things, we just have to be very careful we investigate them. At times, also the priority that they also set up, because just on the back of Shrap, where the same institution complains that they don't have funds to carry out their own activities, but we are just looking at the amount of money that's been expended on accommodation and the rest. Those are huge money. So at times, as institutions complain, you shouldn't be in a hurry to conclude. We need to do a further probe to see whether indeed allocation has not been made. At times, allocation has been made, but it's more into emolument and all those things rather than the core functions. And I think that is where we should be focusing on. We should be putting money in the core functions than any other ancillary services that support the core functions of such department institutions.
Okay, so the other story on the front page, one says 70,000 lost jobs as 60 timber firms collapse. And also Oko Vandapoy elected president of World Mayors. I believe you took that story then. We also have the story of a national service official who has been interdicted over 2 million Ghana cedis ghost payments.
You can imagine. Apparently, cartel that they're able to get you your national service and you do it at home and you still receive allowances. It's, I mean, Daily Guide newspaper this morning, Dumso, blame God, not Mahama. And guess who's saying this? Mariam Sinari is in the pictures. Well, I'm wanting mobbed at home, fire guts ECG plant, Okaiga's wish granted. That's what you see on the front pages of the Daily Guard newspaper this morning. There are certain things that are acts of God. Others are as a result of our irresponsibility and our lack of planning. So, you know, an inspiring national women's organizer of the ruling NDC, Mariam Sinari, says the people of Ghana should blame God for the current energy crisis and not President John Mahama. She said it was unfair for Ghanaians to continue blaming the president when they knew it was God who was supposed to provide for water level in the consumable hydroelectric dam to rise to enable the nation receive constant power supply. Look, I some of these things, these comments are very shallow, and well, to say the least,
because
it's like, you know, the current women's organizer also says something.
I also said something about taking away our
fighting
money.
Our city. You know, so let's be serious about some of these things that are on the hearts of people. Look, the whole weekend hasn't been good for me because I slept in the darkness. And so if you come and sit here and tell me that it's the act of God when you know it's pure lack of planning and incompetence, we are wasting power when we know we can save. You know, so let's just get serious, because it's affecting industry. You know, businesses are suffering as a result of this development. I don't think anybody will be happy hearing this.
As much as I agree with you, I'm also very careful with newspaper headlines.
Well, if she's here.
No, please. Mm-hmm. We all know that you can quote a person and put it in a way it will reflect what the person has not presented. If she's talking about water rising, then it has nothing to do with the president. We all know. And it has nothing to do with the Ghanaian. We all know that those things are natural.
But is that the major issue?
The major point is doomsaw.
The major reason for the doomsaw is not
the water level.
You don't need to probe and in which context?
Because the water level of a consumer is always published in the Daily Guard.
Yeah, but I think it's rising now.
So, because, you see, I like taking people's words. And well, I'm saying because I think she has come back on other station to say that that was not what
she said. Exactly. Okay.
That's why I'm being cautious. If it's on the energy crisis, you cannot hold that. But if it's on the water,
you will also not talk about if it's not about energy.
Again, but generally, absolutely. If you just talk about water, it won't make news. So we have to peg it into the energy.
And something that will make you much more sad than what you're feeling this morning. Yeah. Ghana tops teacher absenteeism in West Africa. Now, Ghana ranks first. Reports from the World Bank and the United Nations International Education Emergency Fund, that's UNICEF, have revealed. Now, according to the reports, teacher migration is a major contributory factor to the low performance of pupils and students in public basic schools in the country. This is nothing to be happy about, really.
But then I'm not too convinced that, I mean, details of the story. Is it migration or is it absenteeism? Because absenteeism has its own effects. I mean, what constitutes absenteeism? And true. I don't think migration has been classified as one of them. When Ministry of Education, the minister taught some of the schools and also came out with their reports. They mentioned some of the things that causes teacher absenteeism, and I never cited migration as one of them. So maybe we have to get details of them. But I think the ministry is also doing well because they reduce it to 22% from 27% within a year, and they are targeting
a zero.
I think the ministry is doing well in terms of teacher absenteeism.
It depends on who we are comparing ourselves with. If we say we are doing well,
we don't need to compare necessarily.
Yes.
We just have to look at the percentages.
No, absolutely.
You see,
we are doing well.
Teacher absenteeism.
But on the West African Sub-Bridge now, you know, platform on education. We are not doing well, so that's not exciting.
And the West Africa Education Ghana is doing well in terms of our student performance in the West Africa.
Yes.
We are topping a lot of, like, maths, for example.
Mathematics and science, and I know.
Exactly. So we are. So
I mean,
so those are some of the indicators of measurement or to performance.
Okay.
Now, when it comes to that absenteeism, I think the Ministry of Education even has come up with a comprehensive work on that as well.
Mm.
And just to make mention of the migration, it's also part because we have a lot of teachers, but all of them have been urban areas. So the rural schools, the rural schools, you know, so we have excess of teachers in urban areas where you have one class, you have about four teachers.
Absolutely.
Okay, where you go to the rural communities, you don't even have one single teacher. Yeah. So this is how the balance, the imbalances they want to correct. Yeah. So I think we should commend them, though they need to do more.
Right.
I think we should commend them on the work that they
did. For me, I believe the Ministry of Education in the last 1 year has done enough work in terms of teacher absenteeism. I mean, they've done enough work. The Enquirer newspaper comes with a banner headline which says, Third Floor in Greater Accra, NDC, Amati Mensah returns. Returns far, hangs at the cooker on a cross of Listerine statistics. And so, Greater Accra NDC still holds, I mean, they are still there. I believe, resigned, I mean, stepped down.
But even he still has some influence on the candidate who is left together with Adekoka.
Yeah, okay.
Because I think Adekoka doesn't have a very good vibe amongst the people in the Greater Accra.
But he's also, I mean, he's also using his performance in the last election as a form of.
So let's hear it.
So while you altruism at work again, he starts clinic at Nyamibetre.
I think this is the town he likes more. Because he's been mentioning names, Kofi Pari and, you know, those places.
The people of Nyamibetre in the Western region have come in the line of altruism as Chuck Kufuayo as the big-hearted politician build them a clinic. So, but First Lady is also in the news. First Lady honored us by City of Newark and also Okubana Poesos.
Is that something we are not seeing, or is it that the prophet is not accepting his own home? Because how can the likes of Okubana Poesos receiving international awards and back at home, their performance we know is shambolic and very, you know,
are you saying shambolic as a matter of fact? Or
no, but why? I don't need to do scientific analysis to know that certain things need to be done, you know, in the metropolis. Accra, for heaven's sake, is ranked the dirtiest, you know, city.
Accra was the fourth most cholera cases, and our mayor is being awarded in terms of business. So you have to balance the two.
Unfortunately, time. But I mean, I'm not saying I'm happy about this, but I'm questioning some of these things.
To use the word shambolic,
yes.
It totally means that all, you see, at least, that's one thing. Flooding in Accra has reduced dramatically. Because he has taken the bold decision to pull down structures that were built on waterway. So you could see that. And at times, do not forget, Accra is very indisciplined city.
Very, very indisciplined.
If you want to compare,
that indiscipline is as a result of the lack of the effective implementation of regulations that are sitting in the books of the AMA.
Exactly.
So you don't blame the people, because if the systems are there, they would obey.
Can I analyze that?
Time, unfortunately. Okay. The Daily Dispatch says Akufo-Addo will win, but will NPP remain united after the October 18th elections? That's what you see on the front page of Daily Dispatch newspaper this morning, right there. Okay, there's another one also here. It says a new proceeding guide. Somanya court remands man. Accra mayor made president of mayors. Congratulations again. Blame God for power crisis. Sinari is here in the pictures talking about that one.
Then Chronicle says Barry do family battle, they are battling the widow, and I believe this is to do with some of the comments she made last week when they celebrated also GMPC bust and Goyle to form alliance to fight fuel shortages, and I believe it's a good call, and we expect them to fight a good fight cause, because where shortages and its associated impacts.
Eddie, as yes, I sir. Affectionately call you,
thank you
so much for running through the newspapers with me this morning, together with Kofi Kuba, who is remaining as our guest this morning. This is the first show. We're also live on Business Africa Live on Business Television Africa BTA. Now, let me just remind you that this morning, you can send us your thoughts, views, comments, and opinions via the text lines that we see on your screens. And today, I am sitting in for your able host, Anil Fuapofo, who is a little under the water. And I just say, as I always say, say a prayer as you do for yourself. Now, still talking about Annie. Now, for the best and the most popular television show host, as indeed she's been shortlisted by the Television Awards Ghana, you've been seeing it running. And for those of you who are watching us at the moment, please pick up the phone and send TAG, T-A-G, that's D-19, T-A-G, D-19, to the short code 1406. That's type Annie and send it tag D19 to 1406 to ensure that she tops up in the voting for the most popular television show host of the year. We'll be back shortly as we go for the Be Motivated segment.
The Television Awards Ghana 2014. Who rules the airwaves? Who takes over television in Ghana? With 100% public voting, you decide.
Well, First Digital TV, indeed, is for the Ghanaian in you. We are moving from T1 to T2.
To vote for Annie Ifua-Ampofo as the most popular television show host of the year, text TAGD19 to 1406. The Television Awards Ghana 2014, promoting core values in television broadcasting.
Like us on Facebook at First Digital TV.
Welcome back from that very quick break here. This is the First Show on First Digital Television. Let's now go for our Be Motivated segment.
Now I feel that this heart of mine has taken many falls. Still sometimes the rain.
That is our Be Motivated this morning for you out there. Just to inspire you, as I always say, motivation is good for the morning and it helps you get started for the day. So pick up this one. The road to success and the road to failure are almost exactly the same. That's Collins Davis there talking about that one. So apply yourself to the very basic principles of life that would help you stay successful. Now, failure is part of life, and as I always say, that if you are out there and you say you've never failed before, that brings to you some questions about how sincere you are with your own self. Now, failure, it depends on how you look at it. You can look at it as an opportunity for you to start again and get it right. You know, no matter how many times you fail, the most important thing is the commitment to correct the wrong. And so let's apply ourselves to these basic principles as we go on in the day. Now, let's get into the discussion segment this morning. Kofi is already with us. As we go on, I'll just say that for those of you who have very basic questions about GN Bank, previously First National, there are a few questions on your mind which you would want to get answers to, exactly, you know, what it is all about and what that really, you know, stands for, what are the major or exclusive banking products they are bringing onto the banking market or the banking industry. Now, it's the new baby in the banking industry, very exclusive, beautiful products they're bringing to you. I'll go for a quick break. When I come back, we'll give you some answers to the basic questions on your mind about GN Bank. We'll get into the discussion this morning. To stay.
The Television Awards Ghana Festival. Who rules the airwaves? Who takes over television in Ghana? It's time to catch the fever as we celebrate creativity and hard work in the industry. The Television Awards Ghana Festival kicks off on Friday, the 3rd of October, with the Industry Awards at the Accra International Conference Center. Then, on Friday, 10th October, the National Theatre will shake to the Primetime Awards. It's a star-studded night of glitz and glamour as we welcome the cream of Ghana's entertainment industry. The Television Awards Ghana Festival promoting core values in television broadcasting. Television Awards Ghana is brought to you by Fritol.
Are you serious?
What?
Why are you trying to shine me? As a Ghanaian, it is your duty to keep your environment clean. You know that?
That's why I pay taxes. I expect Okobandako and his people to be doing this, not me.
Listen, it is an equal responsibility. How do you think the cholera and the other stuff develop?
Oh, master.
Look, I am not moving an inch until you come back for that thing.
Okay.
Let us be each other's keeper and keep our city and our nation clean for a healthier Ghana. This message is by kind courtesy of the Ministry of Local Government and Rural Development and supported by the Ghana Independent Broadcasters Association.
This is Nane Fua. She's thinking about how to cover her university education in the future. Mr. Sari is so confused about how to list his company on the Ghana Stock Exchange. Atta is a organizer and is wondering how to expand his business someday.
Do you want to buy shares on the Ghana Stock Exchange? Or probably sell your shares? Are you interested in investing in treasury bills? Have you been thinking about listing your company on the Ghana Stock Exchange? Talk to GN Investment today. You can reach GN Investment on 030-9788-3809.
EFWA's parents learned from GN Investment how they can invest money to pay for her university tuition. GN Investment helps Mr. Sari with market research, company valuation, and how to list his company on the Ghana Stock Exchange. GN Investments visits Atta and advises him on how to grow his small business.
At GN Investment, we proudly say that we invest with discipline.
Our reporters go beyond the limits, scale over all hurdles to bring the hidden truth, detail that elude the lenses of others. News is that which brings relevance and has positive impact on you. Here at First Digital Television, we focus on the news that gives you what you need to know.
The Television Awards Ghana 2014. Who rules the airwaves? Who takes over television in Ghana? With 100% public voting, you decide.
Well, First Digital TV indeed is for the Ghanaian in you. We are moving from T1 to T2.
To vote for Annie Ifua-Ampofor as the most popular television show host of the year, text TAGD19 to 1406. The Television Awards Ghana 2014, promoting core values in television broadcasting.
GN Bank. Why has the bank's name changed from First National to GN Bank? The name had to be changed because there are too many First Nationals in a number of countries. We therefore need to have a unique identity, hence the change of name. Why the name GN? GN because it is simple. We wanted a simple name, a name that is easy to pronounce. What does GN stand for? What does GN mean? GN is a unique name. It is not an abbreviation. What does the logo mean? The logo emphasizes the name GN Bank. What do the new colors mean? The gold color stands for wealth, cash, sika. The maroon color stands for life, determination, and enthusiasm. What will change for our customers? Better services, more products and services, examples, foreign trade, letters of credit. We can satisfy our customers better. Remember, in all this, GN Bank still remains the people's bank, serving the ordinary people.
So those were the basic questions and answers about the new GN Bank, previously First National. And let me just remind you, those of you who don't have bank accounts, this is a very opportune moment for you to walk into any GN Bank branch across the country, over 100 of them, and open a bank account with just 50 pesos. I mean, you can't find it anywhere. You know, so get in there and go and find out the exclusive banking products they're going to give to you. Kofi Kukubo is still with me in studio. Kofi, it's good, still always good to have you with us. I'm also expecting the Honorable Afenyo Markin, who's a member of parliament for the Effutu constituency, to join us very shortly. And Mr. Seth Hammond, who is with the Progressive People's Party, to also be with us very shortly. Kofi, I was touching on this issue relating to the Auditor General beginning the quizzing of the Shadow Boss from today. And if you see the daily graphic account of that particular story, it says a special purpose audit of the accommodation arrangements and related matters involving the Commission on Human Rights and Administrative Justice Shadow Commissioner Marietta Lamte will be conducted by the Auditor General from today. Now, the audit will also take a peek into Shadow's governance issues and budgetary estimates. And a highly placed source told the Daily Graphic yesterday that the team will be led by Grace Kwachua, who is the Director of Audit of the Auditor General's Department, and will be assisted by two Assistant Directors of Audits. Now, the source says charge officials received a letter requesting the audit on September 25, 2014, The items on checklist for the special audit, the daily graphic length, are what we're told 18, but the source will not give details. Now, daily graphic investigations published in the September issue of the paper indicated that Sharj Commissioner had since August this year moved into a hotel, and I'm not sure we are aware of this detail. But now the Audit Journal is going to start the whole quizzing, you know, of some staff there, and then the Sharj boss herself. I found out your take on this.
Yeah, I think some of us made that call. I think on this same platform, some few days or weeks back.
Absolutely.
That aside the political dimension, where an individual has petitioned the president to invoke that Article 128 or so, administratively, I think the audit department need also to really investigate the manner in which finances allocated to SRAC is being used, whether basic administrative procedures and regulations are being adhered to. If they are not being adhered to, then what are the appropriate sanctions administratively? We all know that the Rent Act itself was violated.
Absolutely.
We may have all kinds of argument about it, but the fact is that it has been violated. Aside that, the amount also involved, looking at the place that was being rented for the purpose of prudent financial management, we have to ask ourselves, is that the only option? Could it have gone in for a much lower, but decent and comfortable? Because once a temporary arrangement, that she need to go to such expensive accommodation. Then aside that also, the hotel arrangement, looking at the amount involved and the whole family involved, these are some to a large extent, does it border on financial misappropriation? I think those are the things the audit department will be looking at. Aside that also, I think the audit department also will look at the internal procedures that govern. So that's where the corporate governance or the financial governance also comes into play. The internal regulations that really govern that institutions in terms of their management of their finances or their funds allocated to them. Whether the procedures that guide, maybe if that arrangement exists at all, what are the procedures that guide such arrangements? I think the audit department is going to look at all these things. As much as we are all talking about Loretta Lambton, because she is the commissioner, that means the head, the ultimate head of the institutions, I have always been of the view that when we look into that critically, and if there should be any something wrong procedurally, misappropriation-wise, not be the only person. Because there are departments and that commission to make, to serve as check and balance on the administration of even the commissioner and even his finances. We should have, I think, they call this treasury department, which is maybe the accounting department. Then they should have internal audit. You see, internal audit are just not there to appear signature and say, okay, this you can go and pay. But they also to ensure that whether the due process procedures have been followed and the amount involved, whether it is really the amount that should be paid, and whether there are other cross-checking that have been done, that alternate arrangement could have been made to prune down the money or the money that has been allocated. Then we should also be examining the estate department as well. So the various departments within the commission itself and their heads, I think we cannot just gloss over and focus only on the commissioner. It only means that if there should be some grievous errors and misappropriation, it therefore also means that there is a weakness in the internal arrangement of that commission. I'm happy that the audit department is entering to really look at those areas and come up with not only punitive measures, but corrective measures also to guide that commission on the way forward.
You mentioned something very critical, the internal structures.
Yeah.
of charge, which obviously could, if were that effective, could have checked this.
Correct.
People have raised issues that could this be a collaborative, you know, act of financial misappropriation, not corruption, but financial misappropriation, which could have been avoided if indeed the structures were working.
And that is what the audit department is going to look at. And I'm happy that they have entered into this. Because we know that the bus stops with the CEO or the commissioner. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, we should not ignore the internal structures and the system, whether there are weaknesses or there are failures. And that is what the audit service is going to investigate. Some might not be punishment, some might be corrective measures, or some it might be that some rules or regulations that there might be taken a second look at and be corrected. It may be some cases too, maybe some may be dismissed or punished for exactly. So to me, the audit service or department is to focus on the internal administration and the corporate governance regulations that govern the whole of the human SRAC and is a financial governance administration. What the Honorable MP has done is to take on a constitutional or to invoke a constitutional matter to determine the competence of the commissioner, whether there is any case against her that warrant her dismissal. Because the commission, as I said, holds a very critical position in our political governance.
Absolutely.
And the commissioner requires, people always talk about competence, but moral integrity.
Absolutely.
Because everything that the commission, the shrug deals with borders on morality. Abuse of power, abuse of office, corruption, misappropriation, these are moral issues. Mm-hmm. That only borders, it's only when the crime is committed, then the law comes in. But when a person has a high moral integrity, he or she will not abuse office. He will not be corrupt. He will not misappropriate. So for the person himself or herself to be responsible to make sure that all those ills are corrected, that person, him or herself, must also be of a high moral integrity. And I think that is where everyone is taking the commissioner on, that her judgment was not correct and the amount involved borders on misappropriation.
But Kofi, then it leads me to this matter, because a lot of people, you see different schools of thought coming to play that, look, this woman should be dismissed. There are others who have come to a defense saying that what is the ground for her dismissal? You know, because if you go into the matter of law, legally you may not necessarily pin her down for anything. But just as you mentioned, that majority of the work or the mandate of the SRAC borders on the moral integrity. And so if you have the head having to battle with such, you know, an issue, it becomes a problem. And you recall that the Ghana Integrity Initiative does this corruption perception index.
Yeah.
So long as it may not probably be corruption, but the perception that people have developed for SRAC as a result of this act could increase the perception about the corruption nature of SRAC and probably may not ignite that confidence in people to actually trust SRAC to deliver justice when they have issues.
You see, you're raising very critical points, but our laws do not work with perceptions. Our laws only work with when there are grounds established. That's why I say you have to prove it beyond all reasonable doubt. The law deals with facts. And the purpose of the petition is to see whether there are facts or there are grounds on which the commissioner can be dismissed. That is the purpose of the petition.
Absolutely.
So the petition is done, saying that, okay, the Chief Justice will look at it and sack the commissioner or recommend the sacking of the commissioner. No. The petition is now going to establish whether there's any prima facie case in the first place, even for a commission or committee to be established to investigate it. Now, if the Chief Justice says that, look, all that you have raised, there's no prima facie case, that ends it. She will continue to be in office.
But how is that going to affect?
No, already the perception.
There's no doubt
absolutely
about that. Public perception. You can go on the street and ask the ordinary person from the street all the way to offices. The perception of that office has already declined as a result of this. There is something that also we are not aware of. Those are the procedural things that the audit service is going to find out. But for you to have some accommodation allowances, it must also be determined by your salary. Mm-hmm. A certain percentage of your salary, I think 20 or 40% of salary, must go into your accommodation allowance. So if she's lodging in a hotel, which is charging $459 or more, a night, the question we need to ask ourselves, is he being taken from her allowances as accommodation allowance? If no, then from what account or what procedure governs that arrangement? When it comes to the temporary arrangement, like getting this accommodation, and if you should rent for $182,000, I think for a year or 2 years, again, we have to look at her salary and see whether indeed, because I think the labor law, if you the company is not providing you accommodation, then there should be a room for accommodation allowance, which must be part of your salary. So all those things have to be looked at. So that's what I'm saying. When we look at just the moral aspect, yes, we may call for her dismissal, but we can only dismiss her, or the president can only act on such accommodation if there are grounds enough. Okay, to dismiss it. We cannot just base it on moral. But in some other jurisdiction, because of the moral hullabaloo and perception of the dissent, some in their own wisdom say that, look, it's not because I have done something wrong, but because of this and the perception that has been assigned to the institution that I govern and my own integrity, I'm stepping aside. But again, it's not everybody who has that strength. It is not too common in Ghana for people to actually step down when, you know, just to even allow investigations to go on. They wait till, you know, they're asked to go. Mr. Seth Hammond is a member of the Progressive People's Party, and he's joined us in studio, communication team member. Zaman, good morning to you.
Good morning.
Welcome.
Thank you.
Great. Let me have your first word on this graphic reportage that the Auditor General will begin quizzing some Shraj staff and then the Shraj Commissioner herself on this issue that has come up with respect to her rent and then other related, you know, matters that is sending that perception of corruption in the commission.
Yeah, I would like to say a very good morning to our cherished listeners and a very good morning to my colleague and you as well.
Wonderful.
Well, all that I have to say is, because of the things that is going on around Shraj, now the whole institution has been tainted. No matter what they do now, their ego has been lowered so low that no one even thinks or talks seriously about Shraj anymore. Because we know what Shraj is supposed to do. They should be the watchers of the labors in this country. In your earlier submission, you said Ghana, or unlike the European countries, that person that corruption has been alleged to will just step down from the investigations to be commenced. But my brother, my problem with this country is we have been appointed by the president. So if the president has not told me that I should go, I'm still in my office. Unlike the European countries, a French minister will be alleged that he has misappropriated funds. Immediately, you just step down for investigations to commence.
Clearly, because, you know, there will be the perception that you can interfere with investigations.
That's it.
So,
but in Ghana, because you have been appointed by the president.
But I'm sure you can still step down, even if the president doesn't ask you to.
My brother, PPP, we are championing for certain things. And I believe if Ghanaians should understand where we are coming from, I think this Chirac issue is just one of those things. We know that the Chirac boss is been appointed by the president with the consent from the Council of State, if they give their mandate, and it's been approved by Parliament. If I'm mistaken, and they have been approved by Parliament. And even the Chirac boss, I think they have the orders of, is it a high court? But this is inferior. The last time I was saying, you could remember when this Richard Anani issue came. It was referred to Chirac. And they investigated and they gave their recommendations to the president. You understand?
Right.
Now, Attorney General says they are going to investigate some Chirac officers. Last week I was told BNI arrested the head of Treasury.
Yes, he was actually seconded into that particular case.
For what offense? For what offense? Boss.
No, but the reason why he was arrested is very different from this.
I understand.
Loretta Lamptey's
okay,
issue.
I understand. So with this Loretta Lamptey's issue, it's telling us that there are several people in so many institutions who have flouted the laws of diverse organizations. And this country, I keep on saying, if I'm the CEO of a company, then whatever I say is final. Who are you to challenge my authority? Maybe what Loretta Lamptey is going through, so many people are also going through that. But yes, I've not come out. Let's look at the woman's issue critical reports. I keep on saying, yes, the woman might have erred seriously. But let us not blame her only.
I mean, I think I made an earlier point that there's some collaboration.
Yes, because former commissioner Emil Short came out because he was then staying in that residence. He moved out. And we were expecting Hannah Bosman to move there. But in one way or the other, Hannah Bosman couldn't. So Hannah Bosman was staying in their own residence. And as my brother rightly said, in the Labour Act, when you are staying, when you are given an accommodation, because I know, say every government appointee, you are being housed by the government. Government gives you a bungalow. And I
supposed to
gives you an accommodation. If in this case the government is delaying and you are staying in your own apartment, the government supports you with 20% of the rent allowance.
Absolutely.
Yes. So let's ask ourselves, for that period that Emil Short left and an ambassador came, for that 3 years, even that 3 years plus that Loretta Lamptey was appointed, what has happened to the renovation of that house? And who is supposed to give that money for the renovation to start? It is the Ministry of Finance. What is preventing them from releasing the money for 3 years? And this one was staying at the AU village. We know, I think the AU village, I think, was given to her by the state. She was staying at the AU village. Her rent expired, and she checked it into an hotel. And she was telling us that it was even the least among the hotels that she checked. Now, another school of thought. She came out and told the public that she doesn't owe any house. The question is, let's look at the background of this lady. This lady was born in Liberia.
Well,
I'm coming.
I thought you were even going to go into the corporate history of Loretta Lamptey. Maybe that would have actually been the case. As in, you know, people have raised issues about her, not necessarily performance, but some issues around her being on the GCB board at the time.
Yes.
But as for, you know, nationality and all that, let's not really.
I understand. That situation not right her now. Performing, I understand.
Ms. Amon, hold on a minute. I'm going to go for this quick break. When I come back, our last guest is going to join us, and then we will kickstart this and discussion again. But this is the first show on First TV on your Effutu television. I'll be back after this quick break to stay.
my destiny. I want to be the one you seek in the morning.
The Television Awards Ghana Festival. Who rules the airwaves? Who takes over television in Ghana? It's time to catch the fever as we celebrate creativity and hard work in the industry. The Television Awards Ghana Festival kicks off on Friday, the 3rd of October, with the Industry Awards at the Accra International Conference Center. Then, on Friday, 10th October, the National Theatre will shake to the Primetime Awards. It's a star-studded night of glitz and glamour as we welcome the cream of Ghana's entertainment industry. The Television Awards Ghana Festival, core values in television broadcasting. Television Awards Ghana is brought to you by Frytol.
National news, parliament, Cinemax African movies, Sports 24, Emmanuel TV, GTV, CNN, Al Jazeera, Planet Kids for Kids, and many other channels.
If you want to enjoy new and exciting First Digital channels, please call our customer service on 0243-002222 or visit any of the over 50 First National branches nationwide. First Digital TV, for the Ghanaian in you.
Welcome back to the first show on First Digital Television here. My name is Alfred Akonsi and I'm sitting in for your regular host, Annie Efuampofo. And let me just remind you that to vote for Annie as the most popular television show host of the year at the maiden edition of the Television Awards Ghana, please remember to type Annie and send it to TAG, as in TAGD19, to the number 1406. Please take note of the process. Type Annie, send it to TAG TAGD19, TAG for Television Awards Ghana, and then D19 to the short code 1406. Do it as many times as you can to ensure that we are able to win. And this is indeed something that we're celebrating and we're proud of. The Honorable Alex Afenyo Markin has joined me. He's a member of parliament for the Effutu constituency. Honorable, it's good to have you.
Good to be here too.
Wonderful. Before we went for the break, Zamon, you were landing on a point when I caught you. You were trying to relate the performance of Marietta previously to you know what she is in the capacity in which she is now. But I'm sure the president and the council of state or even parliament did their own background checks or the woman even before they approve her nomination, assuming, because if they were not so convinced, probably at the appointments committee you could have just asked the right questions to get us the right answers to indeed test whether she was competent for this job.
Well, for competence, I think yes, but let's look at her background.
A background in what sense?
She's a lawyer and a banker as well.
Absolutely.
You understand? So, I believe Shraj issues deals with administratively. And because of her banking role, you know, every banker, when it comes to paperwork, they are number one. And being a lawyer, she also understands the rudiments of the game, because Shrag, when you are in Shrag, you deal with things that pertains to law. You understand? So she knows all for competence, yes. But what I'm trying to say is, when Emeshot was there, Shrag has been in the news for all this while. When Anabosman was there, Shrag was in the news. But when Madam Lamte came, Shrag had even gone down. Let me give you a scenario. They were going to investigate on a certain case, and she came out saying Shrag has no money to do that investigations. But the question that I'm asking is, if they have no money to do investigations,
one of the things I tried to do is, if you could be really specific, what case exactly was that?
Well, they were supposed to go and undertake a certain, I've forgotten, but along the show, if I remember, I will.
Wonderful. I so that our viewers obviously can.
I will just chip it in
to that. You know, because there's been calls that she's not been in the office and all that, and but let me come to Honorable Markins. Your first word on this, considering the facts that we're talking about. The Commission on Human Rights Administrative Justice. I mean, you're supposed to be fighting for the ordinary man on the streets there. That's, if you look at the mandate of Shah as enshrined in the Constitution, basically. But Laurietta has been heard in the past saying that, look, the focus of Shah for her, for the first period, is on human rights issues, not corruption. I mean, to start. Let me give you your first word on this particular situation. In the latest updates that the Auditor General is going to start quizzing some staff, and Marietta herself as a result of this situation.
Well, thank you. My personal view is that the Shrag boss should resign.
He should resign?
Yes.
We don't have that penchant of resigning in this country.
Yes.
We have to be asked to go.
So some of us must encourage her to resign. You see, it is one thing being competent for a job, and another thing, conducting yourself within the confines of the rules and regulations governing that job, the ethics of your profession, how you're supposed to conduct yourself. What are the issues? Issue number one, the woman was appointed, she was living in an apartment. It's the rent for that apartment expired. Issue number two, she is living in a hotel, $450 a night. And three, why is it that for this long while we have not been able to get her accommodation? See, the issue of she, whether or not having been in the private corporate sector, she owns a house, her own house. To me, it's not really the core issue to rely on to ask her to step down. But we know Shrach, as a public funded institution, has been complaining of lack of funds. So the question is that if Shrach has been complaining of lack of funds, why do you go, take a hotel accommodation, and then you say that, well, you took some loans to pay. So would the loans be refunded or not? I think that is an embarrassment. It's an embarrassment to government. It's an indictment on government and Shrag itself for such a thing to happen. Because you see, my suspicion is that because the donor agencies have been supporting Shrach, okay, right, complementing government efforts, those are the funds that they more or less rely on to, because if it's all about government subventions, it's not enough. I mean, even for the whole year, they are not getting.
But then that is even more dangerous.
That is why I think the indictment and the embarrassment comes from, because these donor agencies now look at it and say, oh, so the money that we give you, because it's our money, we have taken money from our taxpayers, we are coming to inject this into this sector of your political institution or, you know, economy or whatever, to support human rights, you know, education and all that, and this is what you use them for. So that is the anger I am trying to look at, because you see, government has even been complaining that donor agencies have not been forthcoming with their donor support. So if Shraj would now want to use funds they receive to just pay accommodation at a hotel, then really, are we serious about the kind of things that we do in this country? Are we really serious about it? So, Madame Lamte, I'm so surprised she's trying to justify why she had to live in a hotel.
But were you expecting anything different?
Well, looking at her background, my expectation was that, you know, she's a senior lawyer, and I find it difficult having to criticize her. But I think that personally, I was expecting her to have quickly seen her conduct as an error of judgment and to have followed with a resignation. Resigning would not mean that she would not be investigated. She will still have to answer questions.
But clearly, in this country, you know, it's a matter of culture. I mean, in other jurisdictions, you resign and not necessarily be tagged as guilty. But in this country, the reason why people are hesitant to resign until they're actually booted out, you know, is that if you resign prior to investigations to prove that you are actually guilty, then you have conceded some guilt in the first place. And that is actually even going to affect you the more. That's when you speak to people, you will find himself in that situation. They would always argue from the legal perspective, you are innocent until proven guilty, so stay.
Well, I disagree with that view. If you resign, you are stepping aside to allow an independent investigation so that you don't interfere. And fortunately for her, she's a lawyer, and she must know that the mere fact that she resigns will not ground any criminal liability or any form of liability.
Right.
Will not. You see, serving in public office, the conditions are different. There are things that in the private sector you will do that it will be seen as normal.
Mm-hmm.
But if you do same things in the public sector, to be questioned.
Mm-hmm.
Why would it be questioned in the public sector? Because you are dealing with public funds. You are dealing with people's money. So one would want to find out why you did what you did. If she were to be in any private institution, she could as well say, you have hired me. You're supposed to provide accommodation for me. In fact, in the private sector, these big banks, if they employ executives and for some reasons they are unable to provide decent accommodation for them, it is their duty to provide, I mean, find an accommodation. And if they'll keep the person in the hotel for even a year, and as long as the person feels comfortable living in that hotel, well, that is it.
Absolutely.
But it does not happen in the public sector.
Mm-hmm.
Public sector, you cannot use the same yardstick, okay, to take a decision. Especially where Shraj, you know, you have commissioners, and you are relying on donor funding and government subvention.
Sorry, Honorable, let me touch you in here. And this question goes to you and Kofi, and then obviously Seth. I think this will be the final comment on this, so we'll move on to the other issues. She was living in the village.
I've been doing some research or asking people who can find out some answers to this question. The rent expired over there, and the AU village is not under a private, you know, administrator. Government still has some jurisdiction over that place.
Government still owns those properties.
So why then, if this is a government official, government has failed to provide accommodation for her, and her rent actually expires over there, and she has to move into a hotel, when you know that it is your responsibility to have actually provided, you know, accommodation for her? Why do you move from a place where you can actually, you own the place? Why do you go expend so much money in a hotel?
Let me start off by even adding to your question and asking an additional question. That how long has it taken the PWD Prestige to renovate her official residence? And is it still undergoing renovation? Why haven't they completed the renovation? You see, and if that question is answered, then we ask the next question. Why did she leave the government official, you know, that apartment given to her at AU village and decided to go to a hotel? What discussions ensued? Obviously, she could have raised the issue with whoever was in charge that, look, it would be more expensive to live in a hotel. So kindly allow me to, let's extend the rent here so that I can bring down the cost than to go to a hotel. She took a loan to pay for the hotel. Took a loan from who? At an interest of what? And who is to refund? What arrangement, you know, did you put in place? Was it approved by you go for a loan? Oh, so if you could go for a loan of that amount to pay for a hotel bill, then why didn't you take that money to renovate your official residence as quickly as possible for you to live in?
Thank you, Honorable. Kofi, your final word on this topic, I need to move on to the subject.
No, the point is that Shrap doesn't own AU village. Mm. You see, we must treat Shrap, though a public or state institution, are independent from the executive. So we must establish that fact. So there was a transaction between an independent public or state institution and another institution or government. So we should establish that. That is why rent was paid. Other than that, rent wouldn't have been paid for the AU village. Why? Because the constitution clearly states that Shrek is independent. The reason why Shrek is independent is to immune that commission from any executive influence.
What is the extent of their independence?
Absolutely independent.
When the commissioner is appointed.
It's appointed, yes. Also Article 70 appointee, but as soon as he or she is confirmed, he or she is independent.
But must be supervised.
Yes, but not by the executive.
No, there must be some.
Yes,
both executive and legislative oversight.
Necessarily.
Else we will leave all
no,
status.
No, you are saying supervised. If you use the word, if it's yes. Oversight, you can't oversight. That's
yes,
why.
Yes, oversight.
Yeah, it's even from oversight. Supervised.
Oh, they are the same.
No,
it's a matter of semantics.
No, it's not the same. Okay. Because you say, if you say oversight, at least, government has some oversight. That is why the Auditor General is a government institution. Have an oversight, that's why they can go in to investigate it, because it's a public institution. But when it comes to taking decisions, internal decisions, it's independent decision, a decision that they must take. Mm-hmm. They cannot have that influence. That is even the reason why the president cannot even just sack her, because of that independence. Okay. That's why you can only invoke a constitutional clause or article for the process to begin. So we must state that.
Right.
But that does not take away the fact that there's a serious error of judgment here that has been established. There's a serious indictment on her and the constitution.
Okay.
And to restore integrity, right, she must step aside, whether she's wrong or not. But the perception about that commission as a result of her presence there, is in doubt.
Wonderful. Yeah. Now, that would tie into another legal matter, because I wouldn't want us to necessarily move away from the legal issues. And, you know, sometime last week, this maritime issue came up. And so let's tie it into it, because it still bothers on law. Ms. Amon, I'll seek your first thoughts on this. The AG, the Attorney General Minister of Justice, Marietta, Brew, Appiah-Oppong, he was exhuming a lot of confidence that, look, Ghana will win this case that we have sent to the court arbitration, I must say, specifically on in the United Nations and having to be with the seas, oversight of the seas. Let's move away from the patriotic perspective to the legal perspective. It's very normal for us to have confidence that as a country we'll win the case, the same as Ivory Coast. I'm sure they're also sitting down saying they'll win the case. Let's look at the matters, the legal issues pertaining to this. Do we really have a case, and how best can we actually solve this?
Well, I'm not a lawyer.
Yeah, I have a lawyer sitting by me.
So I cannot say Ghana stands a chance of winning the case. But I think the Attorney General, being a lawyer of high esteem, understands what she meant by that statement. Now, the question is, let's look at the territorial borders. Do we Ghanaians take charge over that section of the waters? Does it fall within the boundaries of Cote d'Ivoire? Or does it fall back into the boundaries of Ghana? Well, the AG has said she has taken the case to the International Court of Arbitration for people to come and demarcate whether that boundary falls in the lines of Ghana or goes to Cote d'Ivoire. I believe when you have a case in court and you know you have a genuine case, you have all that confidence that you are going to win the case. So I think that is the case from which the Attorney General speaks. But if you are looking at it logically, and Ivorians will even tell you that, yes, we are almost also going to win the case. But at the end of the day, judges who are going to sit on the case, and any judge, I'm looking at goes against Ghana, what is going to be the implication? Will Ghanaians or will the authorities just say that, oh yes, let's leave it because it is not in our domain? If it goes against the Ivorians, would they also do the same? That, oh yes, judgment has been given by an international body, so let us leave the thing for Ghana. I think this is going to be a very long legal battle between Ghana and Cote d'Ivoire, because I believe none of them would just accept defeat just like that. Because if you look at the bands, and I believe if you go to that 3 point where the boundary is, I find it even difficult to even relocate.
I saw the maritime
comes in.
I saw the maritime map, and I mean, they tried to show that demarcation, you know, and make a case that it falls within the boundaries, the territorial boundaries of Ghana. With the map that I saw,
okay,
the Attorney General displayed that map prior to the press conference she addressed last week.
Okay, so what if Ivorians also comes out with another map claiming that portion also falls within that jurisdiction? What I want to say is, let us wait till the International Court of Arbitration settles on the issue once and for all. But if not, here nor there, we'll all keep on stressing this issue. And at the end of the day, it not do either Ghana or Cote d'Ivoire any good. Let us accept where the fault comes. If at the end of the day, victory is for Ghana, I believe it's for all Ghanaians. If it goes to Ivorians, it's for all Ivorians, because what I believe is Ghanaians, we understand things so easily, and we forgo things so easily. Let us wait for them to give their final judgment before maybe we can come and sit here and even start commenting on the judgment that they gave.
Wonderful. Honorable, you're a lawyer, so I'll go into the legal perspective of this particular case, beyond the fact that, yes, we would sound confident as Ghanaians that we're going to win this case. Does the law support this confidence that we have, or that the Attorney General is trying to put out there?
Well, let me start off by commending the government for the initiative taken to seek arbitration as a way of settling this matter once and for all. After several failed negotiations, you know, issues of oil have a lot of undercurrents. Political, international political undercurrent, international corporate undercurrent. There would be business entities who would want to fund it.
And, you know, interestingly, I'm sure some companies have already invested in the exploration.
Sure.
You know,
we know international political interests that would also come to play.
Absolutely.
In such matters, because wherever you find oil, you know you found money. Now, we also have a history on the continent, in the West Africa. We know that the Bakassi Peninsula case, the Cameroon-Nigeria one, which eventually was settled, and concessions are to be made. Now, in the case of Ghana, the history of it dates back to the Buzia regime, where in 1970 there was this joint boundary, you know, commission that between Professor Buzia, of blessed memory, and Hofe Buani, you know, they agreed on demarcating our borders. You know, prior to Buzia, we had serious problems with Cote d'Ivoire because President Nkrumah's ideology and the Ivorian thing, you know, were not that compatible, so we couldn't really agree on the borders. You know, you have a lot of enzymes, some of them are in Ivory Coast, you know, some of them are here. If you go to Brown Hafo, I'm told recently, even Mr. Sedius Katia's funeral, some of his relations came from Cote d'Ivoire and all that. Now, if you look at the Ghana Cote d'Ivoire border very well, it moves up straight, it gets in, it protrudes, gets in again, then there's a strip down. Good. Now, the argument of the Ivorian government, and I did some studies on this during my master's, you know, I did something on the discovery of oil and the potential conflict between Ghana and Cote d'Ivoire, and some of the things that I was able to uncover as part of my research was that Ivory Coast was arguing that the border, the boundary was not a straight one. Okay, now it starts from the inside up north, then it protrudes, gets in again, then the strip. Now we are measuring, taking the equidistance, the strip,
okay,
into the sea, and saying that, look, our boundary starts from the strip because that is the line, and we measure streets and do the equidistance determination. If you take it that way, it is perfect. Okay, however, the Ivorians are also saying that, look, in the 1970 boundary demarcation thing, there were some concessions because of settlement. Okay, so the area that protrudes, for instance, and the area that gets in, that we also conceded some land to them, so we would be wrong. That's the argument, that it would be wrong on our part
to use a strip, that last end.
I wish we had the Ghana map here, so we could just, you know, it would be good, it would be wrong, they are arguing that it would be wrong for us to use a strip down there as the point of the boundary, you know, and then, you know, demarcation.
So that is the argument. They also have a point.
That is the argument. Now we are saying that, look, in terms of land, if we want to take a measurement, you know, do a demarcation, maritime demarcation, you don't the argument. We say that you start from the where Ghana ends, the last and the strip, then you just determine the equidistance deep into the ocean. Then we said, okay, these are our borders. It starts from this point and goes straight line. So it would be an interesting debate. As for issues of law, yes, it's good to beam with confidence, but the opposing party can also raise some very, very tenable, compelling legal argument. But how I see our case to be strong is the fact that we invested, and in all those years of investment, Ivory Coast did not raise an issue. Okay, therefore, it would amount per se me exemplary for the Ivorians to attempt at this belated hour to say that, look, we have a right here. Take your measurement from the northern Ghana, where it is straight, and then that protruding part, after that protruding part, it goes in again. Don't come and use a strip. Take it from the top and draw a straight line. But that is also not possible. We invested all those monies. And take note that Ivory Coast has been exploring, you know, oil. I mean, way back. You know, they've had oil for several years. They don't talk about it. They had areas that they invested. Okay? They didn't invest in those areas that they seem to be contesting. I think my brother has a map.
Yes, but I'm sure.
No, it's not. What is there? You cannot see this now.
Yeah, we would get the map very soon. Now, so
Ivory Coast has been exporting oil, you know, all these years, and they had areas that they invested their oil. So for them to now say that, look, this area we are contesting, one of our strongest points to argue, you know, for an arbitration court would be the investment we've made. And if they had any such interest, why did they watch us to do all those investments without even proposing a joint exploration at a time? I don't know of such proposals, and I did not come across any such proposal from the Ivorian government, you know, for all the period that government of Ghana made investment in that area.
Now,
the other good point to note is that the status quo will remain. The status quo will remain. I mean, there isn't going to be any restraining order against those companies that are working on that Jubilee field, that area. They will continue to do their business, and we should be happy with the fact that at least, in spite of the challenge, both countries are cooperating with each other. I mean, we aren't at war. Ivorians, the worst they've done so far has been with the issuing of letters threatening those oil companies, and so far they have not been up in arms. We've also not been up in arms.
Right.
Both parties have agreed. So I must say, in conclusion, that we have a strong point. You know, we have a strong point. We have a strong case, and I think that we have very high prospects
you know, by way of, you know, getting that Jubilee field back to Ghana. But let me also add that in negotiations, we make concessions. So we're not going to come back 100%. That's what Ghanaians must.
So that's where have a majority.
Ghanaians must prepare their minds. I expected the AG to also, you know, to have said that. That look, obviously, we would have to make some concessions. I mean, it's not going to be 100%. Like I've indicated, that we don't have a straight line map.
Mm-hmm.
Our map, the border demarcation with Togo is better.
Yes,
it's better. Up north with Burkina Faso is it's better. But the Côte d'Ivoire.
That's where it looks like the pregnant.
Yeah, society. That's correct. And that's the basis of them.
With the protruding leg. With the protruding leg.
Yes. that is the germane, you know, issue being raised by Ivory Coast on the way the thing is. That look, you cannot start from the street. We've made investments, we are confident, but obviously at negotiation table, some concessions would have to be made, and we have to understand.
It's worth stating that point, and I do agree with you. You know that we need to prepare our minds that we're not going to have 100%. I mean, Kofi.
No, we may be have 100%.
We may.
It's likely.
How?
No, it's purely. He made mention of some of the historical factors where we started exploration there, and they've not raised any question. Now, the company nearest to the place in dispute is Talo. Yeah, Talo is the one that is nearest to the boundary. So, in any case, that is where the major thing, how do you call it, dispute is affecting that company. Aside that, the historical antecedent which Honorable has elaborated, well, that's also a survey issue. Okay, because the boundaries are pure survey matters. And I've spoken to a lot of surveyors in this country. And they say, when you are surveying, you don't go and put your survey equipment at the place where there's no land. You put it where the land is. And the strip is the land.
I'm happy with the way you and I on the same page. Thank you. When I was doing my work, this was the same, you know, and I foreign argument was that the strip is a small,
yeah,
you know, you can't measure, but
it's a land.
Sure.
Okay.
Sure, but
it's a land. And it's a land that falls under Ghana. Look at the boundary. So when you go and put your survey equipment, you put it, where is the end for the surveyor? Where is the end of Ghana? They'll put it at the end of that street because that is where the land ends. So that's why I say it's a survey matter. There's a historical antecedent. Yeah. There's a legal decision. That is why it is good. That is not going into litigation, but rather arbitration.
Makofi, just for the purposes of...
okay.
Just to add up, this is a national matter, not political. So we all, you know, support each other. You see, the argument of La Côte d'Ivoire has been that they made some concessions. I will try and the next time I come here, I'll try and get that commission, that commission of inquiry that actually went into the matter to finally come out with the report for the demarcation to be done. You see, some concessions were made, and according to Côte d'Ivoire, to them, they think that those protruding areas and that strip was a mere concession. And that we should not take it to be the end of Ghana. Did you get the point? I'm trying to be the devil's advocate here. I'm trying to let the viewers understand the other side of the aisle, yeah. The story of the case of Ivory Coast. To them, that protruding portion was a concession they made to Busia and Ghana. Okay? But if they say that, then they should also not forget that when you are coming down, they also eat into...
Concessions made on the basis of what?
Because I'm settlement, sure settlement.
If they knew that concession was pregnant with such oil wells, they wouldn't have made it, you know, go that easy.
Is it Africa?
No, we've known... Oh, sorry, I'm taking your time.
Yeah, Africa, I was in the
Is it again coming back to, is it because to me these are pure land matters?
Sure.
Okay, boundaries, whether it's sea or whatever, surveyors survey the sea, they survey the river, they survey everything. That's pure survey thing. Now, if there's conflicts over boundaries, whether offshore or onshore, like let's take Accra, between Greater Accra and Eastern region, when concession is made, that means you have rendered that portion of land to the people. So whatever is on and under that land belongs to the people. You have considered that land too. So it's like what they call it. Say you are what's the name? The legal word. Is it underwriting? No. When you hand over a property that once belonged to you and you hand over, that's a legal name for it. It just escaped. Okay. Everything then on that land be citizen. And that concession was made when there was also still dispute over the boundaries. So they have agreed eventually that, okay, we agreed that we'll take this portion. We also take this portion. Ghana then established their boundaries. So that has become the legal boundaries, official boundaries, recognized by all international bodies. That is what anybody that walks into that street, they'll tell that you're in Ghana. Mm. You're no more in Ivory Coast. So again, as I'm saying that, to me, it's a pure survey matter. Whatever concession that has taken place during the past, you have handed over that property or that boundary or that portion of the land to the people of Ghana. I'm sure that is a point at which the Attorney General, Honorable Marietta Brew, upon Appiah-Oppong, okay, is standing on. However, to me, as I said, we have had these experiences in the past. He made mention of the Bakassi Peninsula. It was settled. Even that was even more, it was more violent than even confrontational than ours. We have had at least 10 bilateral meetings which didn't conclude on the boundaries because the Ivorians are still refusing. That's why Ghana was compelled to go to the UN to settle the matter in the court of arbitration. So again, in arbitration, some is from that pure angle, Ivory Coast has no case.
Right. So, well, let me just thank my producers for one. As you can see on your screens at the moment, that's the Ghana map. There, that pregnant.
See the street where you're there.
So that's where we're zooming in now to Ankasa, the Ankasa Reserves, Nyanik Techiman areas, right there on your screens. You see that strip, the
landmass. It's a landmass.
Yes, that landmass there. And you have the southernmost tip over there, you know, going through.
Go up. So, for us to
so progress. Can we go up a bit? Let's just see the topmost part. Okay, so that's what you have in there. The buoy NP there, and that's the Volta, Black Volta going through there. And then you see, there's just another demarcation that separates Burkina Faso from Cote d'Ivoire, and that's the same.
So the point, area. You see, the point is. You see,
so as you see on your screens there, that is how it looks like. So we are battling that line. And, well,
you see, I'm yet to see any country's boundary that is in straight line. I've not seen it before. You see, especially when it comes to Africa, taking into consideration our colonial stories, okay, how those things have been strategically. How do you call it? Demarcated to benefit the various colonialists who were fighting for our resources, and that has been established.
So we can the Cote d'Ivoire Ghana border. We finally agreed on it ourselves.
Mm. Yes. Right? So
not to influence the final demarcation.
Yes.
Between the two governments.
Exactly.
So even if we go to the historical antecedent, we can argue from that perspective.
You also argue from that point that that place is. Is resolved that belongs to us. Mm. So why are you coming back for it again? Is it because of resolve? Because land is not only the surface. Everything that is on it and underneath it constitutes the land.
Mm.
So anything that you have handed over through negotiation belongs to us.
I remember.
So historically,
from a chopping point, because the law will look at those facts. Okay, that's what the law is going to look at. The arbitration is going to look at all those facts and to conclude. So that's why I'm saying, yes, there may be concession, but there may also not be any concession. Looking at the whole antecedent and the survey angle, there may not be any concession. But let's not also ignore the political pressures of the big time countries,
multinational
companies who also have interest.
Absolutely.
There. So definitely, personally, the British should come to the side of Ghana, of course, because Tolo is a British company, so they have to defend the company. No, I'm saying this because there are certain things you have to say it, because now we must begin to appeal to the various international communities. Though I believe the government will be doing it by now. Okay.
Yeah. But I think the Attorney General considered that we've engaged some international arbitrators on this matter. You know, so round it up in 2 minutes for me.
With all the experience that honorable my colleagues, as they were talking, I was beginning to think about that maybe then everything they have made a mistake. That is why they are coming back to claim this portion of the land.
I think it's pretty clear.
They might think they have made a mistake because, as Honorable explained it, it tells us it was a concession. Maybe from Buzia and Ofebu Anita.
That means we have also conceded.
Yes,
we also conceded.
Yes, absolutely. They came into agreement. Maybe the leaders now might think they have made a mistake. If they could look at the land and they'll see how fertile the land is.
They also lost some cocoa lands to
that. How can we leave this land to Ghana? So let us fight over it. That is what I was thinking about. But legally, if we have a case and we think our case is genuine, then I think the government, as my brother rightly said, should start lobbying the international community.
Honorable, the cameras are not capturing that one, what you are doing, but that's for those of us in the studio alone to see. But this is the first show on First Digital Television, and that's how we draw the curtain now on this particular, you know, issue. But right after this quick break, we'll get into the president's speech at the United Nations, whether it was emotional or logical
or dramatic.
We'll find out how emotional it was and whether it actually did that he was hoping to, because I think Ban Ki-moon congratulated him for everything he said.
Ban Ki-moon congratulated every president who made a speech.
Absolutely. After this quick break, we'll stay.
Before you go to sleep at night, I need to be the one you holding. You cry.
The Television Awards Ghana Festival. Who rules the airwaves? Who takes over television in Ghana? It's time to catch the fever as we celebrate creativity and hard work in the industry. The Television Awards Ghana Festival kicks off on Friday, the 3rd of October, with the Industry Awards at the Accra International Conference Center. Then, on Friday, 10th October, the National Theatre will shake to the Primetime Awards. It's a standard night of glitz and glamour as we welcome the cream of Ghana's entertainment industry. The Television Awards Ghana Festival, promoting core values in television broadcasting. Television Awards Ghana is brought to you by Frytol.
African movies, Sports 20,
Manuel TV, GTV, CNN, Al Jazeera, Planet Kids for Kids, and many other channels.
The Television Awards Ghana 2014. Who rules the airwaves? Who takes over television in Ghana? With 100% of voting, you decide.
Well, First Digital Team, it is for the Ghanaian in you. We are moving from T1 to T2.
To vote for Annie Ifwa Ampofor as the most popular television show host of the year, text TAGD90 to 1406. The Television Awards Ghana 2014, promoting core values in television broadcast.
Alright, welcome back to our first show here on February 14th. Now, let's get into just snippets of exactly what the President said. When he addressed the United Nations General Assembly, very quickly, just a couple of minutes of that, and that will set the tone for the final topic of discussion for the show.
We have made little or no progress. I'd like to believe that this is not so. I'd like to believe these events of recent times are merely a setback that will motivate us to find more sustainable solutions. These are just slight reversals on the senior's path towards true progress. Doug Hammarskjöld, who served as the second Secretary General of the United States from 1953 until his untimely death in a plane crash in 1961, said, and I quote, "Peace and progress cannot end in a few years in either victory or defeat. The pursuit of peace and progress with its trials and errors, its successes and its setbacks, can never be relaxed and can never be abandoned." End of quote. In the course of the past several months since the beginning of the Ebola outbreak in West Africa, I have been reminded of both the importance and the practicality. Progress relies on neither victory nor defeat. Progress relies on persistence, on perseverance. Just last week, as the head of ECOWAS, the Economic Community of West African States, told to Sierra Leone and Guinea, they are the three countries that have been most affected by the outbreak of nations were in conflict, wars in Liberia and several countries. Three recorded cases of Ebola, including 2,803 deaths. The World Health Organization predicts that if the disease is not brought under control, the number of cases could easily rise to 20,000 by as early as November. What makes Ebola so dangerous is to compromise our impulse to the world, our impulse to care for each other with the healing power of touch, and to maintain the dignity of our loved ones even in death with a public funeral and a properly marked grave. Mr. President, Ebola is a disease of isolation. Its family members afraid to embrace one another. It leaves healthcare workers afraid to attend to their patients, and it forces the living to.
Okay, so that is the President John Mahama there. Emotional enough, or logical, or
I think you see, I like the way he has situated the Ebola with our social. That is what Ebola is doing to us. We are a nation, or we are a culture of very touchy people. We are a culture of gathering around event and sharing food. We are a culture of hugging people when they are happy or they are sad. And Ebola is really eating away that very culture that has made us what we are. That even in times of very extreme challenges, Ghanaians can shake hands and laugh. It has helped us in several ways. The reason why Ghana in particular is not experiencing so many
conflict or those things. It's because, you see, because of that touchy and the human feeling nature of the people. We don't care. It's only politicians that these ethnic things. On the ground, whether you are a Khan and ever, whatever, we love to hold our people, ourselves and hurt ourselves. And the when you go to the hospitals, our doctors and nurses are also similar. They don't treat you as one of the clients, but they treat you as human beings. And at times, even people come in there to pray, hold the patient's hands and pray. Ebola is depriving that culture that permeates the whole of Africa, or West Africa in particular, that culture. And that is a dislocation of the people. That is why Ebola is so dangerous to us. And I think he has situated it properly to convey to maybe other world that are not content with the lifestyle and the culture and the mindset of people that Ebola is attacking, so that they can understand it properly, so as to bring in the necessary help that is required. Because the delay from the international community may be as a result of lack of understanding and how Ebola is affecting the very nature of the people that is affecting. So I think he has situated it properly
for the international community to understand. The courts that he needed to. Yeah. Honorable.
Well, we know the president is the current chairman of the government.
I'll get into some details of it. I just assume that's well.
He owes it a duty to the sub-region to let the world know that this disease, this virus, is not only killing us, but it's destroying the social fabric of people in the sub-region. And since we don't live in isolation, if the world does not take it, would become catastrophic. Already we know some Spanish who have died, some Americans have died, and people travel for economic purposes, for political purposes, for some other engagement, training, education, what have you. So the manner he did it, well, it's like to make your case for the judge to be on your side. So I didn't really watch the demeanor, whether it was emotional or I didn't really feel it.
But did you see the tears filled eyes, you know, and the wish.
I wouldn't want to comment much on that. All that I want to delve in is the fact that he put out there what was happening in West Africa.
Right.
And to get the international community to invest in research, the international community to come and support. Because, you know, the American who went to Atlanta, you know, he has recovered.
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm. You see, and I always tell people that having lived a bit of my life in the UK for the purpose of meditation, and having seen the promiscuous lifestyle of our Western brothers and sisters, and the fact that
maybe you use the word liberal,
and the fact that and the fact that you come here and you say HIV rate is very high, they may be having something that they don't want us to know. But you cannot tell me that the kind of promiscuity you find in Europe, in the US and other advanced countries are comparable to what you probably may find on our continent. Yet we have high infection rates and they seem to have none. So obviously Mr. President wanted to let them know that if they have something that is a solution to the Ebola, they should bring it down.
They brought Zimab. Zimab couldn't work on some Africans. I don't know if it has a matter of genes or whatever, but I mean, Zim up is what we are.
But it worked on the it worked on some monkeys. Yeah,
that one.
Yeah, but they maybe have something.
There may be absolutely.
Well, the president spoke very well, and he was trying to tell the international community that they shouldn't only sit down and watch Africans die. Because he said on the issue of Ebola, it's not a case for only Africans, but for the entire world to look at. And I think the president wanted to reiterate to the international community that since Ebola erupted in Africa, it is shaking the foundations of our cultural differences in this country. My brother rightly said, in Ghana, you know how we relate to each other. Honorable West greeted me, and I stretched forth my hand and I shook it. Right. Now, because of this Ebola thing, I will just decide to ignore his handshake and just look at him and say, how secure is the hand sanitizer? So I think this is what the president is trying to reiterate to them, that this Ebola is shaking the cultures of Africa. And because of that, people are shunning their cultures. They are running away from what we are used to be. As my brother said, when someone dies, you console that person by hugging. When you see your loved one, you hug your loved one, you even peg that person on the cheek. But because of this thing, people do shy away from it. I think the president is trying to tell the international community, it is high time they come to the rescue of Africa. Because now the number is over 2,000.
Yeah,
the only one.
The known one is over 2,000, but I think the unknown one, we are yet to get the number, as he was saying.
The latest statistics was about 3,500, so...
By November, we are getting to 20,000.
And in Africa, the UN is saying...
You know, my worry is this, that very soon, this Ebola thing may become a political matter. Because, you see, now we are getting a temporary stability of the city.
I was actually going to tie into that. I don't know. I'll definitely have this about six minutes. I don't want our brothers to now blame the president's management and incompetence.
let me
take one aspect of the president's speech. He says, this is an exciting time for Ghana. We're in the midst of transformation, a metamorphosis from a low medical income country into a full-fledged middle income nation. As we all change, it can at times feel daring and at other times feel daunting. Nevertheless, we allow ourselves to succumb to it, to be shaped by it. We allow it to lead us towards our greatest promise, and that is a destination that can never be charted, only discovered through trial and error. Now we have the CD, you know, bouncing.
Back. It's not bouncing.
Well, 3.1.
So I disagree. What is it? It's not bouncing. 4.5. You see, you have received.
I'm asking that it be reflected in what.
For you to firmly say that the CD is bouncing back, you need some supportive statistics on production and business growth. People are not doing business. We are not experiencing growth in production in the economy. People are no more importing. So how do you, by getting the euro bond, getting the cocoa money syndicated funds loan into the economy, conclude that your city is rebounding? You need to give yourself a time. You know, this government has a track record of non-performance. Okay? That we know this government has been taking loans that in the long term, they're unable to properly account for what they've used said loans for. In fact, that is what has overburdened government in spending huge sums of the taxpayers' money in paying servicing interest. So we have to wait and see whether indeed this government is now disciplined enough to put these funds it's going to receive into proper use. If they put the funds into proper use, the city will be stable. Two, they need to give tax rebates. The private sector is being overburdened with taxes. If they give tax rebates, our businessmen would become competitive. They will be able to import and will not have to spend so much on duties and can bring prices down instead of being pushed or cajoled to bring down prices when they have changed dollar at a very expensive, you know, rate to bring good down goods. Again, you see, city stabilization, stability of our city is not going to be sustainable if we do not put in place the necessary economic support systems in place to support internal, they call it homegrown solutions. How are we supporting Association of Ghana Industries? How are we supporting Ghanaian entrepreneurs so that they will be able to increase exports? We need our export sector to grow. For the past 6 years, this government cannot, with pride, talk about taking serious steps to promote the growth of the Ghanaian indigenous economy by way of promoting their exports.
Great.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So these are the things that, to me, will lead to a sustainable, but not this artificial. You go for a loan, you are in crisis. You cannot, if for instance, you cannot pay your children's school fees.
Is not loan.
It's a loan. In that perspective. No. Let me correct that. I mean, if it's a loan to... I'm a member of the finance committee.
I agree.
It is a loan that government is going to pay back. It's with an interest almost 9%.
But you when you're talking about
it, you have to service. Yeah, it's almost 9%. You have to service it.
You
issued coupons.
You don't situate. Okay, I'll not.
No. Let's clarify.
Get your point.
So that we don't mislead our viewers. No, the euro bond is a loan.
We pay back.
So saying that you take your money now, respectfully. If you take the money now, okay, now you've injected, so there's enough in the economy. I'm saying that if you don't put it to good use, the things you want to do with those funds, if you don't invest them properly, or if you invest them and people don't do the work for us to see the effect, okay, you are going to sink again, and the dollar, the city, down.
Absolutely. And infrastructure, you think, is not one of the places you put that kind of money.
Anyway, I support any infrastructure.
I think when we talk about steady stabilization, it is not only has stabilized, it's also appreciating, just looking at the figures. And immediately, definitely the euro bond, the 1.7 billion loan syndicated for cocoa board, and other factors have contributed to that. A very important point. Import has declined. Transaction also in the country, a lot of things have slowed down. When you go to the consumption area, especially the housing, it has slowed down because of prices that have shot up. This phenomenon is not new. It has always every government that has governed this country. Every year out, you see manufacturing declining, and it has declined. We have seen our poultry sector decline over the years. We have seen certain critical areas of our agricultural sector decline, because even when it comes to energy, go back to history, governments have not really invested in energy that should have formed the basis for our economic or industrial growth. So for over, let's get it, 50 years now, we have not restructured our economy away from that colonial structured economy. So some of the things that we are experiencing today is not as a result of NDC in power. It's as a result of the cumulative failures of previous governments and this one as well. But that does not mean I will ignore the fact that we have had of indisciplined government when it comes to fiscal discipline. All governments, it's only when they align themselves.
Probably will take some big daddy IMF will be somewhere to check us.
They always get, as soon as they are born, then we slip again to that indiscipline.
When we tell them, they
Oh, my MPP had the same experience.
Yes, yes. So, they go to IMF to dictate to them. Who told you so?
You can't keep doing the same thing. Your Honorable Alex Afenyo Markin is Member of Parliament.
Afenyo, what to hit that on?
Kofi Kukubo is a governor and social policy analyst. And then also Mr. Seth Hammond is a member of the Progressive Voice Party.
If I don't do it, where else
would I? My name is Alfred Kante. I sat in today for your able host, for example, for who was a little under the weather. Hopefully tomorrow she will be strong enough to
join you. I wish her well.
Once again.
So, which of the weather? You see, the people want to be cute.
All the best for the day, and God bless us all.
Something in my mind. Talk about it. Feeling deep inside. Cannot suppress it. This must be love. I'm not searching no more. I found the one for me. Yeah. You are my destiny. You are my destiny. I want to be the one you seek in the morning. Before you go to sleep at night. I just want to be the one you hold in.
The Television Awards Ghana 2014. Who rules the airwaves? Who takes over television in Ghana? With 100% public voting, you decide.
Well, first, TV indeed is for the Ghanaian in you. We are moving from T1 to T2.
To vote for Annie Ifwa Ampofo as the most popular television show host of the year, text TAGD19 to 1406. The Television Awards Ghana 2014, promoting core values in television broadcasting.
If you want to enjoy new and exciting First Digital channels, please call our customer service on 0243-002222 or visit any of the over 50 First National branches nationwide. First Digital TV, for the Ghanaian in you.
This is Nani Fua. She's thinking about how to cover her university education in the future. Mr. Sari is so confused about how to list his company on the Ghana Stock Exchange. Atta is a organizer and is wondering how to expand his business someday.
Do you want to buy shares on the Ghana Stock Exchange?
or probably sell your shares? Are you interested in investing in treasury bills? Have you been thinking about listing your company on the Ghana Stock Exchange? Talk to GN Investment today. You can reach GN Investment on 030-9788-3809.
Efo's parents learned from GN Investment how they can invest money to pay for her university tuition. GN Investment helps Mr. Asare with market research, company valuation, and how to list his company on the Ghana Stock Exchange. GN Investment visits Atta and advises him on how to grow his small business.
At GN Investment, we proudly that we invest with discipline.
Trying to shine me. As a Ghanaian, it is your duty to keep your environment clean. You know that? That's why I pay taxes. I expect Oko Vandapo and his people to be doing this, not me.
Listen, it is an equal responsibility. How do you think the color and the other stuffs develop?
Oh, master. Look, I am not moving an inch. Come back for that thing.
Let us be each other's keeper and keep our city, our nation clean for a healthier Ghana. This message is by kind courtesy of the Ministry of Local Government and Rural Development and supported by the Ghana Internet Broadcast Association.
This is the story of how cholera changed my village. Tiny germs of cholera, too small to see, spread through the river. So small, yet so dangerous. Without realizing, women carried cholera home in the water. Flies carried cholera on their feet. Unwashed hands spread. Cholera germs in our water, on our food, and on our fingers. It happened so fast. By morning, my father was very sick. He had diarrhea that looked like rain water and poured out of him. I was so scared. I went for help. I never rode so fast. One look at my father and the nurse knew it was cholera. We had to work fast to save him. We made a special drink to help him. First, we made the water safe. We filtered it through cloth and boiled it for 1 minute. Then we mixed half a teaspoon of salt and 6 teaspoons of sugar in 1 liter of this safe water. It tasted like tears, not too salty. I worried my father would die before my eyes, but he soon felt a little stronger. The nurse explained to me that not everyone who swallows cholera germs gets sick like my father, but they can still spread the disease. Now I needed to take safe water to my village and teach them how to protect themselves from cholera. I saw a girl carrying water. I told her she could make the water safe by adding chlorine drops and waiting half an hour. There was a man about to eat with unclean hands. I told him to always wash his hands with soap and safe water after going to the toilet. Only with clean hands could he eat safely. I saw villagers spreading cholera into our river. I told them we needed to dig latrines far from the river, at least 30 meters away. This was important to keep our village clean. I found a mother preparing unsafe food. Wash our hands with safe water. Then we had to wash and put the food, cook it and always eat it hot, and protect it from flies. I spread the word throughout my family. We were so happy to see what was back. Our village became healthy. Now we filter and boil our water to make sure it is safe. We always use latrines and always wash our hands after. Food is safe from flies, washed and peeled and cooked. And we always wash our hands before cooking and eating. We made our village safe from cholera. Spread the word. Your village can be safe too.
This message is by kind courtesy of the Ministry of Local Government and Rural Development and supported by the Ghana Independent Broadcasters Association.
The Television Awards Ghana 2014. Who rules the airwaves? Who takes over television in Ghana? With 100% public voting, you decide.
Well, First Digital TV, indeed, is for the Ghanaian in you. We
are... To vote for Appiah-Oppong as the television show host of the year, text TAGD19 to 1406. The Television Awards Ghana 2014. All values in television broadcasting.
Hello viewers, welcome to your healthy dose of lifestyle tips. This is Get Fat, a program that will delve into anything that you know you just throw at us. We're here to help you live your life the right way. You will get a, you know, we range a whole different range of subjects. So welcome to Get It Right. I'm your host Andrew, and I will take you through tidbits that will help you live your life the right way. So first on our list is the red pepper, and I'm not talking of the Mukoyirawa pepper. I'm talking about, you know, the one that looks like a bell. Actually, you can see this in the visual. They come in three colors. There's a red pepper, there's green, and there's yellow, but they're all called red peppers for some reason. Anyway, these are very high in vitamin C, and they can come at any time of the day, and they can actually be eaten raw, and that's the good thing about them. They actually contain called carotenoids. You don't really want to bother yourself about that, but if you want, you can Google it or you can look it up yourself. And this actually helps the flow of blood. It helps circulation throughout your body, which then leads on to a healthier looking skin. It actually also helps with the fight against acne. So you women, as men as well, I get funny enough, or should I say luckily enough, I get complimented a lot about my skin, and I don't want to sound vain or anything, but I do get complimented a bit about my skin. So it's one thing that I take seriously, and I try and eat as healthy as I can. So trust me, green peppers are definitely a way to go. Now, second on our list, you might not think this because a lot of times people will tell you that chocolate is bad for you. But chocolate is actually very good for your skin because it contains something called antioxidants. And this helps purify the body. It helps with the pores that are in the skin, and it helps the skin looking much more healthier. But don't overindulge yourself, okay? I know people will say it's fattening, but a little dose, too much of everything, yes, is bad. But you have to go easy on it. The darker the chocolate, the better it is. Golden Tree actually have, yes, our own Golden Tree, they have a darker brand. So if you want to go the healthier way, then the darker the chocolate is, the better. Because the ones that are darker contain a higher level of cocoa, and which actually help more with the skin. So an ounce of chocolate a day, the darker, the better, okay? And that would help the road. Now we're going to something that is very tasty to me, fish. Now the fish that can really help with your skin is salmon, okay? I had a kind of salmon. Salmon is the same thing, okay? When you go to the market and you want to get some fresh fish, choose salmon because it's very high in vitamin D. And not only for the skin, it actually helps with cancers, it helps your bones. It actually does a lot of stuff. So get yourself some mackerel. You can grill it or steam it and box it up to work, okay? And when you like a snack, you can only then mix it with your green fish and have a healthy snack, and that would be on your way, or that would take you on your way, should I say, onto the road for healthier skin, okay? Now the omega-3 is another chemical that fish is high in the chemical collection. Hydrates your scalp, it helps your hair. Not only that, I'm talking about, it helps make your skin look flawless. So anytime you go to the market, or you go, nowadays they say because of Ebola you shouldn't go to the chop bar, but if you go to a restaurant or a chop bar for that matter, instead of the bush meat, choose fish, because actually you'll be helping your skin, no Ebola, and guess what, you're helping your skin, you're helping your scalp, helping a lot of things in your body. So just think vitamin D, omega-3, and then think overall salmon, or even mackerel for that matter, okay? Fish is a very good source for healthier skin.